Hi everybody, welcome to day two of the Sehmati Account Aggregator Hackathon. We're really excited to have you back here. Today we have five master classes, actually six. So right now we're going to begin the master class by Perfios Account Aggregator, who I will introduce in a minute. After that we have at 3 p.m. A master class on the sandbox APIs of Yodlee FinSoft. 4 p.m. we have OneMoney. 5 p.m. we have FinView. 6 p.m. NADL, and then at 7 p.m. we have a talk by Lars Markul, who will be talking about successful open banking and account aggregator use cases in the EU and the UK. So before I introduce our first speaker, I would like to just do some housekeeping and admin stuff. Firstly, please do, if you're a participant, please do go to the official Slack of the hackathon. You must go to Slack and check in. So there's a channel called Check-In. So you have to go to that channel and enter your DevFolio ID, and then you'll be checked in for the hackathon. You won't be able to submit a project without checking in on the Slack. The Slack is also the best place for you to get your doubts cleared, to learn, to ask about, to discuss things, share resources, and generally just be in touch with what's happening in the hackathon. For example, yesterday we announced our meme contest, which we also put on Twitter, but we first announced it in our Slack. So essentially, a lot of you guys are really creative, and we believe that it's really important to break down complex ideas and concepts like the account aggregator into simple, shareable, and universally relatable formats. So that's why we're having a meme competition in which we will be, also we just love memes. So we're having a meme competition in which, five people who make the funniest memes, as decided by the Sehmati team, will receive 5,000 rupees at the end of the hackathon. So 25K total prize pool just for memes. So those kind of announcements come first on Slack, and as I said, you must check in on Slack before submitting a project. So please go to the Slack. I'll post a link in the chat to the official Slack. Make sure you go there. Also, we have a Hack Bible, which is the definitive source of all data related to the hackathon. So I'll share that link as well. Do check it out. There are detailed resources there, including a full technical specification of the account aggregator system, links to all of the sandboxes, and a lot more. So please do check these two out. Lastly, I've set up some tables in the social lounge. So in between sessions, between tables 17 and 24, if you scroll down in the social lounge, you can't see it now, but in between sessions, you'll be able to see it. I've set up multiple tables. So I've set up one table for each account aggregator and tables for Sehmati, DevFolio, and Airmeet. So any support that you need, questions that you want to get answered, please go there and check it out. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Vinay Satya Narayan, who is the Director of Engineering of Perfios. He'll be taking us through the Perfios sandbox. Thank you very much for being here, Vinay. Over to you.
Thank you, Raman. Thanks for a warm welcome. Welcome, everyone, on a Sunday afternoon, hard after Sunday afternoon. Let's get started. So this is the second day of the Account Aggregator Hackathon. So we'll be going through for the next 30 to 40 minutes, depending on various how the account aggregator works, various use cases, etc. Fortunately for us, Sid has done a wonderful job of introduction to the AAA tech specifications yesterday on how things work, how the handshake works. So that saves a lot of time for us and also gives you enough education about the entire account aggregator system. So let's get started. I'll just share my screen. Give me a minute. Yes. Can you see my screen? Let's get started. So this is a brief about Perfios AA account aggregator. It's a primer about it. So it's a subsidiary of Perfios Software Solution. Many of you may not know, Perfios is an acronym and it stands for Personal Finance One Stop. That's where we started way back in PFM as a PFM B2C. So what are the fundamental problems today is the consumers are willing to share the data for better services, but they're not very sure of the security part, how to proceed about it, what is the nature of it, etc. And there is no control on who uses their data and why, and once shared, will it be purged? Is it something that you share and it is there forever? How do I know what exact data is shared? These are the common problems of the consumers. So consumer at essence don't know if they are the consumers or they themselves are the product of it. Similarly, for the service providers, there is no regulated, scalable mechanism to get the data in a digital format. It's still a mix and match, part digital, part paper-based, etc. And the authenticity of the data is something that is missing in for the service provider. The service provider could be anyone, bank, mutual fund, equities, any interesting use cases, etc. So this leads to a lot of mistrust here between the consumers and the service providers. So the service as an account aggregators, where independent data fiduciaries that manage the customer consent. So the FIPs, the FIUs or the financial information user can fetch, consolidate, aggregated data from the FIP through an AA, and the citizen sits right at the top of it about the consent and present this information to the FIU. So probably it's just a draft exchange of data. Customer locks in, initiates the consent, seeks approval for creating a consent with an account aggregator, sends the signed consent to the FIP or the financial information provider or any information provider. So now we are talking about financial information provider. The scope only extends as the day comes. Validates the consent, responds it back, and then notifies the customer of the consent creation. The data is pulled in a very transparent, granular way, and it leads to better servicing of the customer. So this is the right time for all these activities, because this is something that the addressable market where we have created is a lending market is around 200 million. Existing loans plus 50 million loans per annum growing. This is in India, and we can definitely have around 80 million users for PFM, 18 million users for wealth advisories. And this is something that we have currently sized. Something that's sized that we are not known is onboarding verification, visa processing for travel, insurance claim automation, and future expansion into various other domains of telecom, health, education. So these are the important parts that would come in, and this is the size of the market that exists today. So some background for this, RBI has created a new regulated entities of NBFC called account aggregators. Account aggregators are data fiduciary. They manage the customer consent, fetch, consolidate, aggregate data from FIP, pass this data to FIU through a proper consent, and they are intermediary and data blind, which means the account aggregator can never open up the packet of the data that they have. They can definitely charge a fee. They cannot undertake any other business, and they cannot store any customer data. That is the background of the account aggregator. Now, what is a consent? A consent is a digitally signed, collected by AA for a user for the purpose for which it's been used. Consent can be queried, paused, revoked by a user anytime. It is generated for a wallet of linked accounts only, and the account aggregators would act as a consent collectors. FIP maintains the most recent status of the consent, verifies it before serving the request, and the consent is always associated for a recorded purpose. You cannot take a data and say, I will use it as it deems fit. That wouldn't fly. You need to have a specific purpose, and you have to use this data for the specific purpose only. Some of the details of the consent, Sid had covered a lot of this in yesterday, is the validity of the consent, the mode of the consent, whether it's a view, store, query, or stream, purpose, there is specific code and description given by the Rebit for the purpose, data owner, so there's the customer can have an AA handle for the data owner who owns this data, the consumer, who is the data, the type of fetch, whether it's a one-time, periodic, every NR, end day, every month, etc., the recurring nature of it. Details of the data, what kind of data is needed, profile, summary, transactions, list of FIPs, asset classes, date range, and other query parameters, and how many days would the consumer retain this data before purging it, whether it is end days, months, years, etc. So this granularity has to come in the consent. As we speak today, in the Rebit specification, you can see some of the financial information that is already provided is bank deposits, including fixed deposits, savings account, current account, recurring deposits, GSTN, that changes the game completely, equity shares, mutual funds, deposits with NBFCs, NPS, EPF, PPF, insurance policy, credit card, and bunch of other ETF and CIS or AIF, etc. Practically all asset classes, not liabilities yet. But as we speak, I'm sure in the matter of 6 months to a year or even more, the scope of this will include will change tremendously. It will include a lot more asset classes, not only on the financial side, on the TRAI, health, and bunch of other verticals. Some of the glossaries there are FIP, it's a financial information provider. Anyone, any regulated entity can be a financial information provider. Bank, NBFC, AMC, depository, participants, insurance, etc. FIU, it's an entity registered with and regulated by any financial sector. AA is account aggregator. That's what today you will spend enough time with. And FSRs are the financial service sector regulator. Central registry, that's a place where all the, it's treated as a DNS where all the, everyone keeps the record of their entries there. And Sahamati, no introduction to Sahamati needed. So in Perfios AA, how do we leverage on our strengths to make sure that this becomes a seamless entry, the citizen is benefited, we see more use cases in the country, and so on and so forth. Some couple of minutes on background of Perfios. We have 10 plus years of experience in extracting, categorizing, analyzing structured, unstructured data. Leading lending, financial management, conditioning, fraud analytics, etc. That makes data valuable. Note that only raw data is commoditized. You still have raw data. Data is like oil. You still need a refinery to extract the petrol and diesel out of it. But the good part of all this account aggregator is, yes, raw data is getting commoditized. Everyone has the same set of data as anyone else. Some of the things that we do day in, day out is scale, performance, security. Security is a job zero that takes precedence than any other things, multiple statements, analyzing those statements and various audits that we go through. So some of the things that we do for our existing customers is management, so that entry is very minimal change for them and they leverage on the strengths of the AA than worrying about the technical implications on how to plug AA. So that they can quickly integrate the application, easily leverage on a large revenue pools and with origin and decision systems, etc. This is most of the customers that we deal with. And the team of Perfios AA, this is for the Perfios AA. Srikanth is the CEO of Perfios AA, he's worked with in the past in Amazon, Amex, Nokia, etc. Govind Rajan, popularly called as Govi, is the co-founder of Perfios Software, has tremendous experience in the technology space. Vishish Chakravarti or DCAC is the CTO of the company. And some of the board members are Sunil Gulati, needs no introduction for him. Has enough experience in banking industry and investment banking. Krishna Kumar Natarajan, popularly known as KK, co-founder of Mindtree, another person who doesn't need any introduction. Everyone is aware of that. And P.S. Jaykumar, who has served as MD and CEO of Bank of Baroda, and also co-founded various budget, housing, and etc. in the past. Now, how does it work? So far, so good. So on the left, you have an information user. It could be invoice financing, flow-based loan, PFM, wealth advisors, health advisors, robo-advisors, wealth and health advisors. Then you have information providers, bank, GSTN, insurance, telecom, health, CBDT, depository, bunch of them who are ready to share the information. And here comes an account aggregator who passes the data in a very transparent, granular way, taking the right consent, keeping citizen right at the middle of it, so that the citizen is in complete control of what data is shared to whom, by when, and how, etc. So this changes the game completely in two aspects. One, it keeps citizens at the top of all the data sharing activity that happen, and it makes for the information user to procure data digitally from the authentic source seamlessly. So this is just a brief architecture diagram we have put. If you're using this sandbox, you have your application that is built, that you would be building for the hackathon, any application that would consume the data from the FIU module, which can connect to any AA. And then there is a central trust store or the CR that we call and pulling the data from the FIP. We'll get into this nitty gritties of this in some time. So let's discuss some of the use cases that we have thought through and put it. Lending today takes various cases of, let's take various cases of lending that happens today. SME, retail, small ticket loan sizes to buy your mobile phone or a laptop. Today, number of documents are procured for this. Some of them digitally, some of them in a paper or a PDF format. Some of them can be tampered with. They are not from the authentic sources. And because of these various issues, you cannot automate this completely. And the citizen is forced to give printout for some, PDF for some, something else for other cases, etc. So this lending is a use case that we have discussed in the past of including Sahai and bunch of other things, invoice based financing, etc., where it can, where account aggregator can solve this problem in a very seamless manner, completely automated, where the credit decisioning can be taken in a matter of maybe less than a minute or maybe 100 seconds, including pulling the data, taking the right decision, etc. So that is a fantastic use cases that that is going to emerge out of this entire account aggregator. The second one is the credit monitoring. This is extremely essential post lending. Typical problem today is borrower and bank do not see each other after lending is done. The banks have to, with all difficulties, catch hold of the borrower for the data. Month on month, they need to call up the borrower for this data, and the bank is at the mercy for them just because they lent the money. So with the account aggregator coming in, because the data becomes so easy to access with the proper consent, you can always pull this data on a periodic basis, say monthly, to say that I pull this periodic data on monthly basis and just to see if there are any early warning signals so that the customer can, this potential loan can turn into an NPA, or the customer may probably miss the EMI, etc. That gives a bank enough protection. They should treat it as more of, this is similar to what you measure an earthquake and a Richter scale. You know what exactly is going to come. It's just that here you know well in advance. So you can always pull data from GST, bank, etc. without any user intervention. Next is the investment advisory. Okay, one of the fundamental problems the investor advises is the kind of documents is collected. Many documents are collected, some are missing, some are unwanted extra document that, that is needed for the financial planning or investment advisory. For example, if you want to provide a platform or a use case that you're building to do a retirement planning, how do you do it? You have to extract pretty much all your NPS, EPF, PPF, pension schemes that you have invested and your salary. That means look at the number of documents you are acquiring, some digitally, some in paper format, some screenshots, etc. And it's a mess altogether today. So with this account aggregator coming in, it becomes extremely simpler to get the data in the raw format from the authentic source and build some interesting use cases. For example, as I mentioned here, investment advisory or financial planning. Another case is an expense manager or PFM, apps such as budget, spend analyzer for millennials that can be built with this data. Goal setting can be done, knowing the spend patterns in case you want to help them in savings or cut expenses, etc. Now that the data you have obtained is from, let's say, in your bank and credit card, you pretty much know the customer's spend patterns. Data-driven cross-sell and upsell. Most of the cross-sell upsell today is not holistic data-driven. They have a small set of data within their environment, and they try to derive some analysis on top of it and try to do a upsell or a cross-sell within that data, which leads to not a good success rate also. Because they cross-sell and upsell is required for two things. One is growing the business. Second one is the customer retention. With the relevant consent and appropriate data, with the citizen willingly sharing, ready to share this data, you can do, businesses can do a lot more cross-sell and upsell for the more stickiness of the customers also. Tax is a big pain if you don't have digital data. Just imagine today the kind of data that you have to collect, all your contract notes, capital gain reports of your equity, mutual fund, bank statements, interest earned in bank statements, real estate transactions, accumulate all of them into bunch and shift to a file, then do the further calculations. The calculations as such is not very complicated in the income tax, to be honest, but the fundamental problem lies in getting the data in a digital format that can be used for all cases. So it becomes, so account aggregator solves a major problem with this, seeing that you can get your bank statements, equity, mutual funds, or any other transactions that you have made in a digital format from the authentic sources so that the tax calculation can happen. Similarly, a reconciliation today, you have a bunch of invoices, especially someone who deals with large invoices. You have 10,000 invoices per month and you have a series of transactions coming in your bank account. All you do is you take printouts of this PDF and start crossing by the marker as to what transactions has come, what has not come. So imagine if GST and bank data would come in seamlessly and you can do fantastic reconciliation of this, of your invoices, which is far less prone to errors and completely automated. Neobanking is something that will definitely be one of the early adopters for the account aggregator. That's a new buzz that's shaping the world, shaping worldwide, with interesting use cases, customer interaction, onboarding, etc. Onboarding cases could be for any of them, as a new customer to a bank, a travel agency for a visa, college, school. If you're at some point in the future, if your education records start coming in through a consent, all of them onboarding can be solved in a fantastic way. The other case is a fraud analysis. So in a fraud analysis today, typically the fraud analysis is more to do with, am I routing the data within my own systems? That means you need to take your bank, GST, income tax, triangulate various sources of data just to figure out that, yes, there is a money routing happening between the concerned parties and it is not the right revenue that has been earned. So these are the use cases that we have broadly put. I'm sure there are fantastic smart developers that have joined the hackathon. They would definitely come up with more such use cases and look forward to a successful hackathon with some interesting use cases that would solve the right problems that exist today. So how can be the solutions be built on it? So then one is an aggregation engine, which takes all the bank, credit card, mutual fund, deposit, insurance, various kinds of asset financial data that is available. It's a data massaging that is done, that is your categorization, classification of data, like people like you, etc. And then you do the analysis among your salaried bucket. How do people behave? Do they take any loan, etc. Spend savings, spend specific or saving specific. And then you build some fantastic applications on top of it. Goal management, financial management, product recommendations, etc. So some of the solutions that PFM has today. Comparing your bank accounts, credit cards, net asset liabilities across various asset classes. One of the problem of the solved, the actual problem that exists with the reconciliation, that is comparing your GST data with your bank account to see where the gap is, how the growth has been, are the collection happening, etc. Some of the things for the financial planning of the use case. Are you really retirement ready? That means that have you invested enough? Are you saving enough that in case you decide to retire at the age of 60, considering some of the known data like inflation, etc., have you made enough investment for this? Some of the similarly a solution for an advisory. I have taken all the data through an account aggregator through a valid consent. I've pulled this data. Now, what are an end user's investment opportunity? Can he spend? There is a lying bank. Lying balance idle on every month, can this be invested, convert into a SIP, etc. The advisory would work seamlessly here. Now, among all these cases, what is common? Yes, we saw series of use cases. We saw series of things that can be built on top of this. We can see how many new emerging cases that we haven't even thought of it would come out of it, etc. What is common among all of this? There are two things that are common among all of this is citizen is empowered to share this data. The citizen says, I need this kind of service. This kind of service would demand a particular kind of data. The citizen is empowered to share the data and revoke it when he or she feels it is not necessary or it is not right to share. So an informed granular consent that keeps the data privacy in mind, that leads to a transparency and efficiency, and that gives all the powers to the citizen. So that is something that is common to among all these use cases. So let's quickly go through a demo of something that we have built. So this is typically one of the views this is a kind of a lending demo use case that we have built for a demo where the customer would come and say, I have a bank account with HDFC Bank or ICICI. Today what happens is the fundamental problem that would happen is the bank would pull the bureau records, know that you have three loans and then you are asked to submit the papers today. So you take the PDF, take a printout of it and hand it over to the bank and they start manually taking a marker, ticking off things and come up with additioning. It's extremely painful, extremely something that wouldn't scale well. And note that here, the citizen is not informed of when your paper would be shredded, that the printout you were given. They may lie forever. that's a security issue for the citizen also. So similarly here, any customer would come, would choose a bank, would give an AA handle. If they don't have an AA handle, it automatically gets registered. We'll cover those steps in further on. And just like your payment gateway, the customer is redirected to an account aggregator page, whatever account aggregator the customer has given, so that the consent approval happens in the account aggregator page. In the interest of time, I'll skip the linking and discovery of accounts that's covered in the documentation that will be put in the Slack channel. Now, the customer has linked here three bank accounts and one GSTN, or two current accounts and one savings account at an Acme FIP, or it could be any FIP. The customer is at complete. Now, the complete rights resides in the customer for two things. One, I don't want to share this data, so the customer would click on reject this request, meaning I will not agree to this. This is asking more data than it is asked to us, etc. And the second one is the customer need not give data for all the accounts. The customer can always select some of the accounts or unselect some of the accounts. And in case it is an SME lending, would want to unselect the savings account and only give the current account which the entity is running for. Or it's a personal loan, would only give savings account, would not even share the current account or the GSTN. This is something that the customer has all the rights. The citizen is empowered with this. So this is the construct of a consent where a lender would say they want to fetch your transactions, profile, summary. That's some of the details that we covered yesterday. From deposit GSTN accounts for a particular date range, depending on the loan type and the purpose. And how frequently do you want to pull it? What do you want to do with the data is something that you specify with the customer, with the consent. In this case, the data is not stored. Note that you can store the data. Nothing stops you. The regulator does not put any ban on the storing of data as long as you have a valid consent for it. The customer has given some of the accounts here. Now the customer says he has agreed to this consent and is redirected back to the lending page where the customer was interacting. Many things happen at the background. The consent is approved by the FIP. The data is pulled to the standard APIs in an interoperable model. And then this is one of the case for an SME where an interesting report is generated looking at the bank and GST data for a working capital loan. Without wasting time, I'll just open the report directly. So something similar to this, where we check the variance from the bank and GST statements, how much is quarter on quarter, there is a actual deficit because the moment you raise an invoice, the collection could be happening after 90 days or after 45 days, etc. So some of this is just one case of the report that we that can be prepared. This is just an illustration of the entire flow. And the end of it, they're saying that, yes, the loan has been approved here. Or in principle approval, then to further on to a dispersal in a digital way. So these are, this is just an illustration of one of the use case that we have built. Similarly, there are far more use cases that this hackathon would see with interesting people coming in there. Now, so far so good. How do we get started with Perfios FIU sandbox? Is there is a Google Google form link that is pinned to Perfios sandbox. Click on it. Give your team name and your email ID because you need to communicate in case we need to communicate it. Something's there. And submit, an organization would be created for you. And an entry would be put in a CR and three profiles would be created by default for you. Now, what are these three profiles? Is we'll create one for bank, one for GST, one for bank plus GST. The reason for these profiles is you may have various use cases. For example, you may say that I only do a PFM. Now, PFM is largely perspective in nature. A PFM for a salaried is very different from a PFM for an HNI, is very different from a PFM for an advisory, and is different from a PFM who deals with an SME. An SME would want to know bank GST, how it is doing, can the SME save cost on the OD account limit, etc. And savings module would like to, an expense manager for a PFM is different. So we create various profiles for your various use cases that we have. By default, we create three. We can add n number of your profiles. The link will be shared in the Slack channel for your API documentation, and that will be the endpoint, demo-fiu.perfios.com. So you can ping Perfios sandbox for Slack channel for any of your queries, and then proceed with it. So as a team in a hackathon, you want to try multiple use cases. Some of the use cases that we have lists, SME lending, consuming bank and GST, PFM consuming bank data, retail lending consuming bank data, credit monitoring, consuming bank and GST, reconciliation, onboarding of a customer. Onboarding could be seeing that, have I built a platform which just validates if a bank account for this customer exists? And then if it exists, then I would like to open a DMAT account for this user and proceed. So that you would take a consent only for a profile or a summary and need not deal with transactions. So you really are taking the data in a granular form. So you want to try this multiple use cases. We create multiple profiles for you, as simple as just a drop-in configuration so that you can get started on it. Just let us know what kind of profile you're looking for. And in case you're not sure of it, feel free to talk to us. We'll help you. So we'd like to see various use cases that's being built in this hackathon over the course of next 4 weeks. Now, how do we track what we've been using is get an admin portal for transactions, utilization, errors that would have happened. I made a request to, for example, in case one of the FIP is down and if the customer wants to get the data, you may want to put an upfront warning saying that, hey, do you know this bank particularly is down? In case you are sharing data with this bank, please try later, so that rather to fail early than fail later. So something, you get a full-fledged admin portal with a role-based access. This is something we haven't opened up for the sandbox because there is need to register for the role-based access. It only makes things, we want people to solve use cases than tracking. Now, the flow is very straightforward. There are only a handful of APIs for you to call. We call it initiate registration and consent and pass a mobile number. If the customer is not registered in AA, then it would automatically register him. You get an URL, you redirect the URL to this, you redirect the customer to this URL. Approve the by default for every customer registered. Acme Bank 3 accounts and 1 GST is already discovered. Just click on link all to link them. And then you invoke a data fetch, approve the consent. The data fetch is invoked. You can pull the raw report. For hand sandbox, we are giving the analyze report. You can pull the raw report. And now you have a bank GST data as per the schema specified in Revit to build some interesting use cases on top of it. In case you want to using an FIU sandbox. Now, in case you want to use an AA sandbox, that is you are building an FIU on your own and then further on downstream process of this, there is an API link. All these details will be shared in the Perfios Slack channel. The endpoint of it is uat01.perfiosaa.com. You can take the Postman collection. Similarly, just like FIU also has a collection so that you can quickly get started all in org ID and API key. Once you make an entry in CR, let Perfios know AA know that your entry in CR so that in case of any queries, it becomes easier to handle. And ping Perfios sandbox for any queries here. So look for Perfios sandbox for more updates, interesting quizzes over the course of next 4 weeks. Please interact for any help needed, whether to discuss your use case, technical problems, understanding of schema, understanding of the structure, any of those things. Feel free to discuss. We will put some of the SPOCs also from our end so that you can discuss in case you don't want to put it in the group channel, you can interact with them directly also. Okay, so that's the final step. All the developers, assemble. Let's get started. Let's make the best cases in next 4 weeks to best use cases using the account aggregator. Some fantastic use cases, something that we have not thought of, something that is revolutionary in nature for the account aggregator. So, and then the last one, these are really unprecedented times, untested. Be like Mandalorian, always wear your mask in public. This is the way, there are no other ways. So any questions so far?
Awesome, brilliant. Thanks a lot, Vinay. We do have several questions. So I think can you see the chat tab on the question tab on the right? Sorry.
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe you want to stop screen sharing also.
Just a second. I'll do that right away.
Awesome.
Yeah, done.
So if you could please start by addressing the most upvoted questions on the question tab, which are the first few that you'll see. And just to the audience, if you like a question, you can upvote it and it'll go to the top. So once Vinay answers the questions, I'll move them to answer. So over to you, Vinay.
How would you cross-sell, upsell happen if a consent is taken for a purpose? It again depends on the purpose that you take. Today, Revit has defined only a handful of purpose. That is only for around 6 of purpose for it. And over a course of time, it will definitely expand because everything needs a specific purpose to be filled. Only then it would be served. So it's a matter of time where there will be certainly new purpose that would be filled. Suppose an app access AA data for PFM. Can the app run additional analysis on the data to sell the user products or show offers. This is something that can be debated, but ideally I would have preferred it as a no, because as a customer, if I was your customer, I would have said that I'm sharing you a data to show my expenses, to track my budget or to set a goal. And if you're analyzing or taking this data to cross-sell certain things, there needs to be taken a valid consent for this, because that's not the intention of the data that have been shared. You said the data can be pulled without user intervention, but the consent of the user is required every time to pull the data. This is from Andrew that. See, what happens in a typical process is post-approval, pre-dispersal, you would take a consent saying, if you're taking a loan for next 5 years, I'd like you to take a consent to pull the data for every month for next 5 years for the accounts that you have shared the data for the credit decisioning. So in which case, typical problem that exists today is, after I disperse a loan, on the first or second of every month, the bank RM calls a customer today, hey, you have taken a loan, but I need to assess your early warning signals, etc. Can you please share your bank statement, GST, etc. and keeps following it up. So in this case, because I have given a consent that can pull the data recurring in nature, I need not call up the customer. The data directly comes and sits in my LOS or LMS or any of the decisioning system so that I can effectively take a look at the early warning signals. Can a user stop or expire the consent before actual expire period because of certain security issue reasons? Yes, definitely. Note that this is a citizen charter. This is the entire power is for the citizen. So if, as a, for example, if I'm using a PFM and I feel that they're not doing the right justice to me or they're misusing my data, etc., I can go ahead and revoke a consent completely. Absolutely. As a customer, I have all the rights here. And fortunately, these rights are not something that I have to fill in a paper form and submit it somewhere, etc. I just go to a portal, an account aggregator portal, and just say that revoke this consent, period. No questions asked. Your consent is revoked. Further data fetches will not happen. Should the FIU delete the transaction data if consent is revoked by the user? These are all some of the interesting debates that we have had in the past. If you have taken a data and you have a data retention policy of N days or N months, you should delete or purge the data after N days, because the framework never stops you to take I need data for to store data for 1 year. The framework gives you all the flexibility, but having stored data for 1 year, you should delete it after a year. Now, if the customer has revoked the consent, yes, there is a right to forget, which means you need to delete the data ideally. Can we take consent for cross-sell, upsell as well as specifically from the customer? I've answered this in the past. While using the AA sandbox, is it possible for us to define new FIUs, meaning the FIUs limited by the four regulatory scope to expand beyond as this fell? Yes, definitely. We look forward as to more and more kind of data. In fact, FIU is not even the right term. It should be information user. It may not stick to the financial world. It can stick to TRAI or health or any such things. For example, you can as well, if the TRAI data comes, you can as well analyze my telephone bill and says that I'm wasting too much data, I need to switch to a plan, etc., as I would have given you a consent to pull my data, pull my telecom bills. How should teams choose AA to pick work with all? What parameters should be evaluated? This is completely left to the developers. This is try out most of them, my suggestion. As much as possible. I know 4 weeks you have a bandwidth constraint also. So choose, pick whatever that facilitates your use case so that you can build use cases on top of this. When I revoke the consent, then my data will be purged instantly or based on frequency. I can speak for ourselves, it is instantly, but I'm sure there will be, as we scale things, it will be frequency also, which means by at least EOD, it should be deleted. But ideally, I would have preferred to delete it instantly. how will an AA make sure that I'm not storing the data which has read-only consent? Now, once an information user has taken the consent, they have to adhere to the principles of the consent. The construct of the consent, that is, whether you are doing it for a read-only, you're not storing the data, recurring fetch, etc. And you have to adhere to it. While there are two implications, one is a reputation, second one is the regulations. Both play a vital role in this case. Can a consent given for multiple accounts later be updated, as in from three accounts reduced to 1 year, from 5 years reduced term to 2 years? As of now, no. At least in the current structure it exists, you can revoke this consent and ask the information user to take a new consent. That is the easiest way to have. As of now, you cannot meddle with the construct of the consent once you have accepted it, because the information user has to be appropriate. For example, I may want, in case if I'm doing my tax calculations, I may want 7 years or 8 years or since inception data. And after giving it for the first year, next year, if you cut it down to 1 year, I may not have the right, I may not be able to service the customer. Suggestion is to revoke the consent and ask the information user to raise a new consent. And if it doesn't deem fit for the information user, they will not raise a consent for that. If we need to do complete profiling using loan, saving, tax, etc., can we get all purpose combined in a single request or get a single consent? You would have seen this in the presentation. Is a consent has a purpose. A single consent has a single purpose. You cannot club things here saying that I would like you to take your PFM data, data for PFM, and then if the data looks good, I would like to offer you a loan. No, that won't fly well. Could you share the list of FIPs and purpose codes which are available right now in production? Let's stick to the sandbox. The purpose codes are defined by the Rebit. We will share you the Rebit link. I'm sure somebody website, it's there out there in public. And note that this is an initial draft of the purpose code. So I'm sure over a period of next few months, there'll be a lot more purpose code that would come out of this. Can a consent be revoked through an FIP directly? Would FIU be informed when a consent is revoked? When a consent, I'd like to split it into two parts. When an FIU, when a consent is revoked, all the parties involved in this, the customer has revoked the consent, the FIU and FIP are duly informed immediately, saying a customer has revoked this consent and there is take the appropriate action on servicing this customer, etc. In an FIP also, it can be revoked because I can walk into a branch today and close my bank account. Which means there has to be a facility in an FIP to revoke a consent. There could be a consent associated to this account. And then the FIP would inform the account aggregator, which in turn it would inform the FIU saying, yes, this consent is revoked. Are there standardized payments between FIU and AA, or does the FIU have to negotiate payments terms and methods for each individual or AA? There are no standardized APIs for the payments, but I don't think anyone is charging for the hackathon. Let's admit it. And it's completely free for you to test all various use cases, build more use cases on top of it. So payments part, there are no standard APIs. I am not sure if there would be any standard rates also. It would definitely vary between one AA to another AA. What financial institutions are currently sharing the data? Are all the banks, data brokers participating currently? As of now, the schema is completely nailed down, which means all the use cases are considered, all the data points are handled for banks and GSTN. Brokers, we haven't nailed down it yet. So at least in the bank and GSTN, the rubber has hit the road. We have seen some of the use cases emerge out of it. We know how to use this data. That means all the data points that has to be covered is done. Brokers, not yet. But it's more of a time thing than any technology stopping, etc., or something innovation has to be made. The core API layer exists, and there won't be any change in the API layer, whether you integrate with a bank or GSTN or equity or NPS or EPF, etc. Your core APIs would still continue to be the handful of those APIs. It's just that the only difference would be is the schema would change between the data. That is obvious to happen. GSTN will have a very different data compared to bank. that is something that will definitely happen. And that is the only change you have to go through it, even when the day we have brokers, mutual funds, EPF, PPF, etc., that would be sharing the data. How the data revocation and audit trails are supposed to work? See, when the customer revokes an consent, the customer is notified of the revocation that you have revoked a consent. This is more of FYI, just like your OTP or anything that would come in from, you know, payments gateway. The audit trail for all the customer action is maintained as it's a regulated entity. The customer can always question, when did I revoke this consent? What was the purpose of it? What timestamp, etc.? The audit trails are only persistent. The data is never persisted. AA is anyway data blind. Even if the any AA decides to persist the data, the AA is only leading with a blob of encrypted string, which it cannot decrypt it. Fortunately enough, work has happened in the past to make sure that the data is rightly encrypted and no one else can mediate in the middle.
So Vinay, sorry to yes. But just jumping in here, really excited and glad to see that the chat is so active and that, you know, all of you have so many questions. That's superb. Please continue asking them. You know, Vinay, we've actually set up a support table. So after the session ends, there'll be a support table where, you know, you can go and ask questions to Perfios people. As I said, 17 to 24, I believe, are the numbers for the support tables. We can set up more Perfios support tables as well. So just keep an eye out on the tables to see, you know, which one appeals to you. We have to move into the next session, unfortunately, but I would like to thank Vinay. You know, fantastic presentation. Really excited to see what people build using the Perfios sandbox. And just a reminder, please join the Slack. You need to check in on Slack. There's also a Perfios support channel there with a dedicated team to resolve your queries. So everyone, a round of applause, please, for Vinay. Thank you, Vinay. I hope you can see these emojis and hear them virtually. So thank you, everyone. We'll be back at 3 p.m. with Yodlee FinSoft. So in the meantime, please enjoy the social lounge. Vinay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Raymond. Thank you, everyone, for the wonderful participation.